Hi, it's Aaron Barnhart of the Kansas City Star, and I'm here with Steve Glorioso, political consultant. We're talking about the fairness doctrine. Steve seems to believe, along with a lot of nostalgic liberals, that it's time to bring back the fairness doctrine. I'm not so sure. Tomorrow, the Tea Party, being sponsored by anti-tax groups, you seem to think that this is a cause for bringing back the fairness doctrine. Why?
Well, it's a great example of what I've been saying for a long time, is that the taxpayers are basically subsidizing the political right wing of the United States, and the teabaggers, that's what I call them, are here tomorrow. They're being promoted, driven, organized by talk radio with not a scintilla of the other side, people who disagree with them, being allowed to interject. So basically what we have is a nationwide rally tomorrow by a virtual handful of people. I don't care how many people they turn out. It's a minuscule, organized by talk radio using the public airways.
First of all, the Fairness Doctrine, which was outlawed in 1987, even at the time that it was starting to fall out of fashion in the Reagan administration, the circumstances by which you even needed a Fairness Doctrine were drifting away. Since 1987, you had a whole plethora of alternative media to present views. I mean, I made a list of them here. Public radio did not exist in 1987 in any really meaningful form. It only grew up since then. You had the number one and number two networks in cable news right now are Fox and MSNBC. They did not exist in 1987. Comedy, satire, all over the dial, wherever you go, you're going to find from Stephen Colbert to David Letterman, who I think had a pretty serious role in undoing the campaign of John McCain, to Jay Leno, to The Daily Show. Those didn't exist at that time. Alternative weeklies, the pitch I don't think was very powerful in 1987, and then of course, to say nothing of the blogosphere. So, with all these forces here, I think the argument is that the Fairness Doctrine is no longer needed because it was promulgated at a time of spectrum scarcity, which just doesn't exist anymore.
Well, except the one segment that you touched on is AM radio. And that is a spectrum that I think is very much in need of the Fairness Doctrine. The conservatives say, well, if there was the liberals could get an audience, there'd be liberal radio. Well, the fact of the matter is that station managers won't take a chance. And secondly, I was part of one of the most successful radio shows in Kansas City in the late 1990s with Jack Cashel called Friendly Fire. Both sides being presented. And when I was leaving town at the time, but when I left the station and the program, I think we were number one in our time slot. People liked it. They just haven't been made that offer. You know, if the right-wingers want to control AM radio, they think they own it, I would suggest they go to satellite for a while and see how well they do there, as opposed to using the public airwaves that I'm paying for.
Well, okay, the public airwaves is one of these things we hear talked, discussed, but, you know, the point is most of these companies are privately held. Mm-hmm. They're usually not local in nature, and they have they make market decisions that I think work for them. The other point is that the Fairness Doctrine came about at a time in the 1940s mm-hmm. when broadcasters were running away from public controversy.
Yeah.
And the Fairness Doctrine basically said you need to present both sides of an issue, but that gave broadcasters the license to present controversial issues. In reality, mm-hmm. if you had to ensure fairness, you lost out on the controversy. So by the repeal of the Fairness Doctrine in 1987, I find it coincidental that in 1988 you saw the rise of Rush Limbaugh. I think the Fairness Doctrine going away, and that fear that they would always have to cover on any controversial issue, they would always have to be on pins and needles, wondering if somebody was going to sue them for an opposing point of view.
Yeah.
Once that went away, then you could allow people to do their thing.
Yeah.
I just think that controversy is one of those things that is the catalyst for democratic discussion and debate, and it doesn't have to be fair. It can be radically unfair mm-hmm. because in a marketplace that now has a variety of ways to express themselves, people are going to seek out varieties of opinions that some of them will come out ill-informed, some of them will come out well-informed. But you can't really argue that there's an absence of discussion, which was the big fear in the 1950s, well, that some giant corporation was literally going to control the message.
Yeah, but it stems, some of this attitude stems from the right wing, the political right wing, the Republican Party, etc., believing that the major networks were biased, which I don't think they can prove, that the news presentation, day in, day out, I mean, they can cite a story here, cite a story there, were biased. And so what they've done is retreated to talk radio. I just finished reading a little while ago Scott McClellan's book. He was press secretary to George Bush. He said they had a full-time staff member who did nothing but stay up all night and get the talking points to send out early in the morning to Laura Ingraham, Rush Limbaugh, and all of the talk radio people. I mean, it's a cabal that's been created.
Yeah, but
and
I'm just saying...
You know, how do you have controversy when you only have one point of
view?
It's
a cabal, though, that is listened to by, I think that people overestimate the power and the reach of conservative media, both talk radio and Fox News. I've heard these estimates that 20 million people listen to Rush Limbaugh. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that the total accumulated people who watch Bill O'Reilly in 1 week, that's about the size of Rush Limbaugh's audience, mm-hmm. which would put it at well under 10 million people. Now, 10 million is a lot of people, but they're just representing one point of view. And frankly, the rally that's going on tomorrow mm-hmm. is a steam valve for people who feel like, you know, that their people lost the election, now they've got $3 trillion of debt, boom, dumped on them like that. Mm-hmm. Yes, the previous president did a lot of piling up debt, but you know, he did it in the installment plan, okay? they're getting this all at once. They're feeling some shock and awe, and they're reacting in the way that Americans do, by having rallies, and yes, flooding the zone of their friendly media, which in this case happened to be 98% of AM talk radio stations. I don't see a problem with that. If you go to Twitter right now, you will see lots of people, you know, rallying opinion against the right wing. If you go to a site, it's called twazup.com, twazzup.com, and you will be able to see by the second people piling on their tweets against this the teabagging rally.
That isn't nearly the reach of God knows how many AM radio stations in the country that carry local right-wing radio, like we have here with this crazy right-winger on 710, or Limbaugh, or Sean Hannity. I mean, it's a convenience that the right wing has that's not available in that format to other people. I don't understand how anyone could be against fairness. I mean, it's just, they are going to get sued. It's just a matter, I'll give you another example. One day, Obama gave a speech. I went around the dial. Most of the stations, news and NPR, etc., carried the speech. Limbaugh didn't. He talked all through the speech. Then when it was over, he lambasted the speech. But the people that listened to those radio stations all over the country weren't allowed to hear the President of the United States. That's the kind of fairness that ought to be...
I think those people are have no problem not hearing the original on X Brigade. I mean, that's
they
why
don't want it.
They want, if they want that, they can go to C-SPAN. It's in 100 million cable households in this country. Well, as they say on cable news, we'll have to leave it there. I'm Aaron Barnhart. This is Steve Glorioso. Ramsey Mohsen, thank you so much for doing the work here on the camera and putting it out there to the Twitterverse and the blogosphere. And be unfair. It won't hurt you.
Thank you.